share a song with you from Psalms 27, written by Christopher Walker. The Lord is my light, my help, my salvation. Why should I fear? With God I fear no one. God protects me all of my life. With the Lord, what should I dread? The Lord is my light. The Lord is my help. The Lord is my salvation. There is one thing I ask of the Lord that I long for. All of my days with God to be dwelling, gazing with awe at the beauty of God, and in wonder look on God's house. The Lord is my light. The Lord is my help. The Lord is my salvation. I know I will live to see the Lord's goodness. Now in this life, I am sure I will see it. Trust in the Lord, be strong and be brave. Wait and hope for God our salvation. The Lord is my light. The Lord is my help. The Lord is my salvation. The Lord is my light. The Lord is my help. The Lord is my salvation.
Good morning, everyone. I'm glad Bill was with us here this morning, because I know no matter what I say, we've already been blessed. Amen? Thank you. Today I get to talk about something that I'm kind of excited about. Those of you that know me know that CCA and Christian education is a big thing to me, and I appreciate your time and listening to me this morning. Shall we bow our heads before we begin? Heavenly Father, thank you for this Sabbath. I thank you for this opportunity to present this message today, and I just ask that they be your words, not mine. Just give me the strength today, in Jesus' name, amen. Put these on here real quick. It's good to see all of you here today. Okay. Once again, I'd like to thank my wife for helping me put this together. I'd probably still be at home typing if it was me doing it, so I appreciate her help in this. It's been a blessing. A man was once spending time with a Scottish sheep herder. Is it kind of ringing a little bit? A little bit. Thank you. Noticing the herder was uncommonly quiet, the man asked him why. What's going on? The herder replied, I lost 65 of my best lambs last night. The wolves got in. The man then asked how many of the older sheep were killed. The herder looked at him in surprise and said, "Don't you know that a wolf will never take an old sheep as long as he can get a lamb?" By now, you may be wondering, what does this have to do with Adventist education? The famous preacher, Charles Spurgeon, once said, "Take care of your lambs, or where will you get your sheep from?" I believe that Christian education begins in the home. Ellen G. White writes in Chapter 1 of Child Guidance, "It is in the home that the education of the child is to begin. Here is his first school. Here, with his parents as instructors, he is to learn the lessons that are to guide him throughout life's lessons of respect, obedience, reverence, and self-control. The education influences of the home are a decided power for good or for evil. Parents, remember that your home is a training school in which your children are to be prepared for the home above. The home should be a preparatory school where children and youth may be fitted to do service for the master, preparatory to joining the higher school in the kingdom of God. Let not home education be regarded as a secondary matter. It occupies the first place in all education. Fathers and mothers have entrusted to them the molding of their children's minds. How startling is the power. As it said, as a twig is bent, the tree is inclined. True education is more than a preparation for life that now is. It develops the physical, mental, and spiritual powers for service, not only in this world, but in the world to come. Now, while I believe the education of our children begins in the home, I believe that both the school and the church have a profound impact on their development. They're like each of a leg on a three-legged stool, and each one has a vital part in holding up the child. It is on the leg of Adventist education that I would like to take some time to discuss and focus on today. And while my focus is on Adventist education this morning, I want to be very clear that I'm not putting down on our many amazing educators and students who are in public schools. God has called each of us to different walks in life, and their example may be the one thing that makes a difference to those around them. Those educators and students have my full support and encouragement. If you are a young person who can't attend the Adventist school for any reason, don't despair. God still can bless your learning experience at a non-Adventist school or at your job. In fact, he can use you as a missionary to share the gospel through the example of your godly life and acts of kindness. But I also believe that the Adventist school system was initially designed by God to prepare the pupil for eternal life, not just for academics in this life. I'd like to just take a second here and talk about my own experience in my education. I grew up in Walla Walla in College Place, and I started out, my parents held me out of school until I was 7. And they kind of did some little homeschooling stuff up until that point. And then they put me in school at a public school called Davis Elementary School in College Place. And they put me in kindergarten, and I went to kindergarten for 2 days. And then the teacher wrote a note in cursive handwriting so I couldn't read it. And she safety pinned it to my shirt and said, "Take this home and show it to your mom." And so the next thing I knew, I was in second grade. Okay, and I went over to Rogers Elementary School, which many of you know in Walla Walla, in College Place there. And I started out there in second grade. I went all the way through Rogers Elementary School, up through eighth grade, and graduated from eighth grade there. Then I went to Walla Walla Valley Adventist Academy, WAVA, for half of my ninth grade year. And then my mom moved to Lewiston, Idaho. And when we moved to Lewiston, they had a church school there, but it was only up to eighth grade. So I was already past eighth grade, so I had to go to public school. And I went there, it was Jennifer Junior High School was the name of the school. And a funny side note is Mrs. Gable, our music teacher at CCA, actually was the band director at Jennifer Junior High later on, not when I was there, obviously, but she worked there before too, so it was kind of interesting. But I went to Jennifer Junior High the second half of my school year, and I immediately got, I want to say labeled, or yeah, labeled's a good word, I guess, as somebody that didn't smoke, didn't drink, didn't chew tobacco. And that kind of limited my friend group a little bit. And then in my science class, I remember the science teacher was talking about evolution and teaching evolution, and I basically told him I didn't believe it. And we kind of got into some discussions about it a little bit, and he labeled me something that I won't say, but it was in all in fun. I think he appreciated me, you know, standing up for what I believed and stuff, but that was an interesting part of my public school experience there. Then the next year, we were still living in Lewiston, so I went to Lewiston High School for my 10th grade year. Now, I went from, at WAV, I think I had like 33 kids in my class, something like that. And in 10th grade at Lewiston High School, there were 750 kids in my grade alone. So you want to talk about a culture shock. It was a big, big difference for me. And some of the things that I learned in public school, I learned how to play hacky sack out behind the gym, listening to AC/DC and Motley Crue, and I'm not proud of that, but it's still to this day when I get in a customer's car and the radio's on and one of those songs come on, I can still remember every word. I wish I didn't, but I still do. But and I also learned about Greek mythology. You know, Shauna, when we're watching Jeopardy, sometimes she's amazed, like, how did you know that? When a question about Greek mythology will come up and I'll answer it or something, you know, she's like, how did you know that? Well, it's something I learned in public school. I also play the trumpet all the way through elementary school, and then at Lewiston High School, I got to play jazz music for the first time with my trumpet. And I really enjoyed that. That was a lot of fun. It was very different. They wanted me to play in the pep band with them at all the football games and different games and stuff, but being there on the weekends, I just said no, I wouldn't. And they respected that. But it was a lot of fun to do that. So after Lewiston, we moved back up to Canada. Mom met Garth then, and they got together, and we moved up to Alberta, and then back down to Okanagan Adventist Academy in Kelowna, British Columbia, for my 11th grade year. Had a great experience there. There was 11 kids in 11th grade, I remember that. So from 750 kids down to 11 kids, so it was a lot different. I met some really neat people, got to make some really good lifelong friendships there. Then after 11th grade year at Okanagan Adventist Academy, I transferred down to Upper Columbia Academy, UCA, and I worked there for the summer, making some money, and then I went to the school there the next year for my senior year. And I, coming down from Canada, I had enough credits that I was able to graduate at the semester break, so I didn't have to finish out the school year there. I came back to Wenatchee and went to the WVC. When I was 17, I jumped right into college. This is before they had Head Start or Running Start. So I kind of did the Running Start thing, but I was a little bit young to be doing that. My grades didn't really do too well. And I went there for 2 years, and then I told my mom, I said, you know, I think I want to go to Walla Walla, Walla Walla College. And she goes, and what was your GPA again? And without saying exactly what it was, I'll just say, she goes, when you get it up to a 2.0, we'll talk about it. So that'll give you a little, you know, idea of what my GPA was. But back then I was racing cars, working at the shop, and going to school. And you can imagine the priorities where those fell in there. School was probably closer to the bottom than it should have been. But I went to Walla Walla after I got my GPA up. And you know, decide what I want to do. I said, well, I like playing racquetball. I like wearing sweats to school. I like playing sports. So I went into to PE, a physical education degree, with a concentration in secondary education. I wanted to be like a high school PE teacher. I thought that'd be really fun. So I started taking some classes at Walla Walla, and after I think it was two education classes, I was like, no. This is not for me. It was quite obvious and apparent that I didn't have the patience to teach young people. And so they offered a new concentration at Walla Walla. In fact, I was the very first one to graduate from Walla Walla College with this concentration. It was physical education with a concentration in fitness management. And what that was a degree that you taught you all the physical education stuff, but also prepared you to run like a health club, to be a manager of a health club, to work in a health club, to own your own health club, that kind of thing. And so my internship, I was at Columbia Basin Racquet Club in Richland. I did my internship there, learned how to do a lot of things there. It was a lot of business classes and stuff. And so I'm right now in my current profession, I am using my business classes more than my physical education classes. Everybody, you know, you have your degree in physical education, why do you work on cars for a living? I'm like, well, that's an interesting question. And I think only God knows the answer to that, but that's what I've been chosen to do from him. But it's been interesting how God's worked in my life through my education process. When I went to Walla Walla my second year, my senior year, I had a roommate, Scott Griswold. I don't know, you may have heard of him. He's been a missionary to Thailand, and he's a pastor, I think, somewhere in Texas now. I've lost track of him, but he was my roommate. And even though I was, you know, raised Adventist, went to church my whole life, you know, fairly conservative and all this stuff, I never really had a relationship with Jesus, if that makes sense. And Scott was the one that really helped me with that. He taught me to pray, and to pray to Jesus as a friend. And I can say that's probably, you know, when I really started choosing to go to church for my own, you know, not just because I had to or my parents wanted me to. You know, that's when I just started to develop my personal relationship with Christ that's carried me through to this day. And I really attribute Scott's influence. I also learned a little bit of Greek and Hebrew through him because he was having to learn that while we were rooming together. It was kind of interesting, but he's a great guy. I consider him my guardian angel in a lot of ways. He influenced me in ways that affected my life for good. But that's kind of my educational journey, if you will. My father, Don, I talked to him here this last week about this topic, and he was raised, he wasn't Adventist, but his dad and mom became Adventist not long after he was born, and they made him go to they only had a one-room schoolhouse out in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan that he went to growing up, but when he was old enough, he went to Canadian Union College, or CUC, up in Alberta, and he didn't do, like me, he didn't do so well academically. But he told me, he said, if it wasn't, he went there for 3 years. He said, if it wasn't for those 3 years, son, he goes, I don't think I'd be in the church today. You know, he said that whatever it was that they had going on there, for some reason it stuck. And he really attributed his, you know, where he is at in his Christian walk today from that experience as a Christian school. So we all have different stories, but that's mine. So I'll get back here. Find out where I was at here. Sorry. Okay. As every parent is a shepherd with a flock, and every church member is a shepherd, so too every teacher is a shepherd with a responsibility for a flock of students. We should be thankful that Seventh-day Adventist schools can join hands with the home and church in this critical aspect of guiding our children to a saving relationship with God. They can also teach according to the Bible and what God ordained, different from what public schools are currently allowed to teach. Our scripture today from Psalms 144:12 says that our sons may be as plants grown up in their youth, and that our daughters may be as cornerstones polished after the similitude of a palace. Our goal is not to only educate our children scholastically. There is no doubt one may depend upon public schools to educate our children in science, math, music, art, and the like. Even if some teachers would like to present biblical truths, the law does not permit them to do so in the same way that we currently can in a private school. Ellen G. White writes in chapter 52 of Child Guidance, "It was this that impressed upon our minds the needs of schools where religious influence should predominate. Parents, guardians, place your children in a training school where the influences are similar to those of a rightly conducted homeschool. Schools in which the teachers will carry them forward from point to point and in which the spiritual atmosphere is a savor of life unto life. Whether or not our youth who have received wise instruction and training from godly parents will continue to be sanctified through the truth depends largely upon the influence that, after leaving their homes, they meet among those to whom they look for Christian instruction. Upon every Christian parent, there rests the solemn obligation of giving to his children an education that will lead them to gain a knowledge of the Lord and to become partakers of the divine nature through obedience to God's will and way. In our churches, there should be a school and teachers in these schools who are missionaries, trained to act well their part in the important work of educating the children of Sabbath keepers, not only in the sciences, but in the scriptures." So what is Cascade Christian Academy, or CCA? It is a K-12 Seventh-day Adventist school located in Wenatchee. Now, how many of you here know about CCA? Okay. How many have attended or graduated from CCA? I want you all to look around. Okay. I'd also say, who has either graduated or attended an Adventist school at some point in their life? Okay, that's definitely the majority of the people here. Amen. CCA's mission is to enable learners to develop a faith in God and to use their knowledge, skills, and understanding to serve God and community. They are training children to live for Him. I thought this was kind of interesting. CCA was established 118 years ago. There are currently 208 students attending and 26 faculty members. CCA offers a rigorous academic program, student-led chapels, as well as athletics and a school-wide music program. Seventh-day Adventist education has emerged as the second largest Christian educational system in the world. How many knew that? It's the second largest in the world. The first Adventist school opened in 1853 in New York with five families cooperating. In 1872, the first school sponsored by the Seventh-day Adventist Church was opened in Battle Creek, Michigan. In 1874, the first Adventist college opened. Others soon followed, and in 1893, the first Adventist college outside of the United States was opened in Kenilworth, South Africa. Since then, Adventist elementary, high school, and colleges have flourished worldwide, creating a vast network of educational institutions. As of 2018, a few years ago, there were over 8,800 Adventist educational institutions across the globe. That's not students, that's institutions, that's schools or colleges, 8,800 across the world. That really surprised me, that was amazing. I praise God that our church family here at Valley View supports Seventh-day Adventist education and our Cascade Christian Academy. The largest part of our budget here at Valley View goes to supporting our church school. Adventist education, like most other private institutions, may not always be cheap, but compared to the benefits, it's priceless. The fact that you have designated a part of our budget to educating our young people shows that you feel this is important as well. Many people ask, is it worth the cost? Because yes, it is a costly program. It consumes vast amounts of money and demands much sacrifice on the part of parents, students, and the church. And Adventist educators understand that not everyone can afford to attend an Adventist school, so they found ways to still make it possible by having a worthy student fund, where the school raises funds and uses them to sponsor promising students who have applied but can't afford the fees. You may have noticed the offering during the children's story goes into the little red schoolhouse up here in the front. All this money is applied to the Worthy Student Fund, and it's an easy way for us all to help students around CCA. The prevailing notion is that real evangelism efforts are aimed at conversion of adults. But George Barna wrote a book entitled Transforming Children into Spiritual Champions, and in this book noted that only 6% of those over the age of 19 make the decision to follow Jesus. We all like a return on our investments, and there's no other group than children that will pay us greater dividends, amen? The greatest window of opportunity that you have to bring someone to Christ is when they are under the age of 19. Christian education is an effective evangelistic tool that we as a denomination cannot ignore. It is an eternal investment, an investment in every child that goes through it, an investment into not just what he or she will be, but what who or she will become. Not only are we reaching our own children, but over 60% of the children attending CCA are not from Adventist homes. Students from all faiths and cultural backgrounds are accepted into our schools. Church attendance is not mandatory, but children placed in our schools receive scriptural lessons, memorize Bible verses, hear regular Bible stories, and are encouraged and taught how to have a relationship with Jesus. This teaching goes from K through 12, which means 13 years of teaching Jesus. Each day starts with prayer and worship. Students are encouraged to develop a strong, heartfelt connection with God. It is a goal that our principal, Stephanie Gates, shares with every tour she gives to prospective parents and students. In this way, our school becomes a strong mission field, not only for children from the Adventist faith, but children who would never have had the opportunity to hear about Christ otherwise, or minister to. As our teachings and faith values impact them, parents, family members, and friends will see the change in their children and become curious about the God who their child has come to know. Children share what they have learned at school with their parents, and this may help lead them to Christ. I've heard of this happening numerous times. On one hand, we celebrate this excellent evangelism opportunity. We have to be very careful that the majority of students being non-Adventist do not negatively impact our mission and have a negative influence on the other students. We need to strive even more to make sure that there is a positive influence and that this larger section of non-Adventist students is not leading the other children to follow examples that we do not support. I know personally that this can be a huge challenge. When many of my child's friends at school do not believe the same way, do not go to church on Sabbath, do not have the same morals or values that I am trying to impart, and they put peer pressure on my child to do things that we would not believe are right, it can be disheartening and challenging to get them to stand up for what they believe and not give in. Our children and teachers all need our support and encouragement to be the positive example of these non-Adventist students. Reminds me of a story. My grandpa, some of you remember my grandpa. He was a member here for a long time. He passed away a while ago. He was an Adventist student in a non-Adventist school, and he was getting pressure to drink alcohol. And I tell you the story because it's a story that's helped me in my life to keep from drinking alcohol. He told the story about how these guys had a bottle of whiskey, and they wanted him to take a drink. And they just kept pressuring him. And so he finally goes, okay, give me the bottle. And he took the bottle, and he run his thumb down the side of the bottle. He goes, how much can I have? And he ran and said, okay, you can't take it. You can't handle any more than that. So he took it, and he goes, and he poured it out on the ground. He said, they never bothered me to drink again. As I have previously stated, while I believe that education begins in the home, the school and church are the other legs of the stool on which our children rest. Ellen White emphasizes this when she counseled, while we should put forth our earnest efforts for the masses of people around us and push the work into foreign fields, no amount of labor in this line can excuse us from neglecting the education of our children and our youth. So what are the main reasons we should support Adventist education? Number one, spiritual focus. Without a doubt, we need to be preparing our children not just for success today, but for eternity. Beyond the book work, Adventist education seeks to infuse biblical principles in all areas of student life. There is intentional dedication to spiritual and character development. Teachers serve as role models and mentors as they patiently instruct the children and show friendship and concern for their spiritual journey. Teachers make the Bible the basis of all instruction, and the principles are infused into the whole curriculum. Prayer, scripture readings, and worship are part of the daily school routine. Number two, academic achievement. Cognitive Genesis, a four-year study of 30,000 students enrolled in Seventh-day Adventist schools across North America, found that these students achieve an average of half a grade above predicted ability in all subjects. Recent studies show that students in Adventist schools outperform the national average in all subjects, all grades, and in all schools of all sizes. That says a lot right there. At the NAD accreditation in 2017, CCA was rated highly effective, which is the highest rating you can achieve in all nine standards. Even with all the success, Adventist educators will seek out new ways to give students the best learning experience and remain relevant in today's fast-changing world. Number three, I've alluded to before, the student-to-teacher ratio. Having a low student-teacher ratio allows for more individualized instruction and attention. Development of students' individuality and God-given faculties allows students to reach the highest potential, their highest potential. And even if they happen to have any learning challenges in a given area, there will always be ample room to find a place where they can excel and feel validated. That's a lot easier done in a class that has 30 kids than 750 kids. Number four, involved parents and staff. Parents and staff are encouraged to communicate, and parents have more opportunities to volunteer in the classroom or on field trips or on other activities. Number five, community service. Students are encouraged to be active in the community through various projects, ranging from raking leaves to singing in nursing homes. Adventist schooling at its best leads a person to a lifelong dedication of service to others. Not only are the students encouraged to be involved in their local community, other service activities such as mission trips expose them to different cultures and ways of thinking. I know I've been down to Belize with the school on a mission trip, and it's a life-changing experience for these young people to see how the other part of the world lives. You know, that they're very blessed and very fortunate to live in a country like we live in and have the blessings that we share here. Learn practical healthy living. Students are taught health principles for living a healthy full life, including proper exercise, nutrition, sunlight, water, temperance, and caring for both our minds and our bodies. Number seven, healthy social interactions. Many students attend small classes in our institutions for many years and have the opportunity to get to know their fellow students on a deep and intimate level, creating lifelong friendships. My older daughter, Casey, and Trista were both at CCA for 12 years. They went all the way through. And Christina is now in eighth grade there. They've made lifelong friendships there. Christian school means investing in the future. Results may not be immediately seen, but the seeds that are planted are sure to flourish in the future. It takes a great amount of faith to put that seed in the ground. Yet, if we have faith and plant the seeds in the hearts of our children, we can rest assured that the Holy Spirit will bring growth and harvest from our efforts. This is the time, more than ever, for the church to invest heavily in our children's education. Psalms 127, 3 through 5 states, "Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring, a reward from Him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth." Ellen G. White writes on page 555 and counsels to teachers, parents, and students, "With such an army of workers as our youth, rightly trained, might furnish, how soon the message of a crucified, risen, and soon coming Savior might be carried to the whole world. How soon might the end come, the end of suffering and sorrow and sin. How soon in a place of possession here, with this blight of sin and pain, our children might receive their inheritance, where the righteous shall inherit the land and dwell therein forever. Where the inhabitants shall not say, 'I am sick,' and the voice of weeping shall no more be heard." God is raising up yet another generation in these last days. The great partnership of Adventist education can never accomplish its mission if the educators work alone. If you remember, the three legs of the stool are home, church, and school. Home and the church's congregation must be involved at all times. Trying to determine which of these three critical components is not necessary is like trying to choose which leg on a three-legged stool is indispensable. God has given the SDA Church the responsibility of doing all they can to support and encourage these young people to be strong men and women of God. Whether or not you happen to have children who are of school age, you still hold an invaluable role. There are numerous ways you can get involved. First of all, with supporting our principal, Stephanie Gates. She has the awesome responsibility of guiding the CCA ship through its ups and downs, which requires much strength and wisdom and long nights in board meetings. Secondly, the teachers and staff. All CCA teachers attend one of our churches. Do you hear that? All CCA teachers attend one of our churches, and we have many teachers from CCA who attend church here at Valley View. They certainly all deserve our support and words of encouragement. Take time in your personal devotions to pray earnestly for each one. Ask them how you can help support them. How about taking an active role in nurturing students? Let the children in our church know that they are important and that they matter to you. Children and youth need to know that they belong, that their church family is supportive of them and not just their critics. It encourages them to know that their Christian education is a responsibility with which the whole church identifies and accepts. It encourages their parents, too. Attend school functions and other youth functions, such as Pathfinders. We have a Pathfinder Bible experience going on here today. Come out this afternoon and see for yourself what these young people are doing and how amazing they are. I know seeing you here supporting them would mean a lot to them. When home, church, and school pull together, Satan will find little area in which to work, and God can fulfill his promise, as stated in Isaiah 49:25. I will contend with him that contendeth with thee, and I will save the children. Above all else, lead by example. Help our children see what godly Christian men and women look like. Let them see our successes as well as our struggles, that they may learn to lean on God in good times as well as bad. Our education doesn't stop simply because we graduate from school. We should spend our entire lives learning about Jesus and his love and how we can share it to others. Pray each day to see more of Christ and to allow him to lead each and every one of us to God and our Savior and best friend. Remember to encourage our school leaders, teachers, and staff. But most of all, remember the students. Pray for them. Lift them up. The trio of home, church, and school is like a strand with three cords, which the Bible says is not easily broken. Pray for Adventist education and the mission field of CCA.